Namaskar and welcome to Sunset Television. I am Vishal Dahiya and you're watching our show Perspective, where we bring you detailed analysis of key national and international issues. Today, we're going to talk about the assembly elections in five states. Now, the Election Commission of India has recently announced the schedule for assembly polls in five states. A little over a fifth of India's population will vote between 10th of February and 7th of March in 690 assembly constituencies spread across these five states, which include Punjab, Goa, Manipur, Uttarakhand, and the most populous and politically significant Uttar Pradesh. While voting in UP will take place in seven phases, starting from 10th of February, voters in Manipur will cast their vote in two phases on 27th of February and 3rd of March. And Punjab, Uttarakhand, and Goa elections will be held in a single phase on 14th of February. Counting of votes for all these five states will take place on 10th of March. So we'll get the final results on 10th of March, almost 2 months after the first vote has been cast in these elections. In today's episode of Perspective, we will discuss and analyze key issues during these assembly polls and also the electoral strategies of various political parties involved here. And for more on this, we're joined by a distinguished panel of guests from across these five states. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with... We have with us Mr. I.P. Singh. He is assistant editor with the Times of India in Jalandhar, Punjab. We also have with us Mr. Siddharth Kalhans. He is a state correspondent of Business Standard in Uttar Pradesh. And Mr. Kishore Nayak Gaonkar is joining us from Goa. He is editor, Gaon Varta. And Mr. W. Rorke Chand Singh is joining us from Manipur. He is a correspondent with Organizer Weekly. Welcome, all of you gentlemen, to Sunset TV. Let me begin with you, Siddharth, first. And of course, it makes a lot of sense to start with the most important state politically, a significant state rather, as well, and the most populous also, that is Uttar Pradesh. So if you could take us through not only the key issues which are being talked about there, or which are at the high point of this election campaign, which would have already begun, but also the electoral strategies, quite a lot of political happenings taking place in Uttar Pradesh, a lot of movement.
In Uttar Pradesh is quite different from earlier, the previous elections. Number one, because after, say, a gap of more than 30 years, we are seeing a bipolar election in Uttar Pradesh. Last it was 1989, and now it is 2022, when we are seeing a almost bipolar reaction in Uttar Pradesh, where on one side it's BJP with allies and on the other is Samajwadi Party along with a smaller alliance. So it makes the contest more interesting because on almost 80 to 85% of seats, there is a direct fight between BJP allies and Samajwadi Party allies. Another thing that makes this election more interesting and extraordinary one in, because of the COVID impact that has restrained political parties from the routine kind of electioneering and the routine campaigning and rallies and big road show and all that. So this time, most of the parties, they have to depend on their digital strategies, digital campaigning. Till date, before the elections were announced, almost all the parties, they had already started their campaigning. Front runner, among those who had campaigned was obviously BJP, where the Prime Minister, as well as the Home Minister and the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, they had almost covered more than 60% of the assembly segments in Uttar Pradesh. Now, once the election schedule were announced, and the parties are facing difficulty because other than BJP and up to bit Samajwadi Party and Congress, the parties are not digitally geared up.
Okay.
BJP has a network, BJP has resources as well as digital infrastructure to address voters, whereas other parties, they are lagging behind when it comes to digital campaigning.
Okay.
Though now the parties, so it's quite late, but now the parties are gearing up for digital campaigning.
Indeed, indeed, that part is going to be really interesting to see. There, Siddharth, you're right in terms of digital campaigning, because the COVID pandemic seems to be changing the way elections are contested, and the campaigning is also done by these political parties. But you mentioned, you know, that very important aspect there, that seemingly this time around in Uttar Pradesh, it's a two-way battle between the BJP and its allies on one side and Samajwadi Party and its allies on the other side. But there are two more, you know, important players in the state. What about them? What is their, you know, standing vis-a-vis these elections, the Bahujan Samajwadi Party, BSP, and the Congress as well?
See, Bahujan Samaj Party, they have suffered a setback in the recent past with most of their loyalist leaders. They were quitting party, and the party is losing base among its core voters, that is the Dalits. Mayawati, she herself belongs to Jato community. So there in Jato community, she still has a strong base. But other than Jato, there are other communities which fall under the category of Dalits.
Okay.
But there, the party is losing its influential leaders as well as, in fact, legislators from other than Jato community. They have also deserted Mayawati.
Okay.
And above all this, Mayawati somehow hasn't, you can say, hasn't geared up for the elections. Till date, she has only addressed two election rallies and has not addressed people. She is not at all campaigning. When it comes to Congress, still they are toiling hard. They are trying to create a niche, a new segment of women. Like Priyanka Gandhi has given a campaign in the name of Ladki Hoon, Lad Sakti Hoon, addressing the women voter, the female voters, and they have so many programs for female voters.
Okay.
But see, when in the election, actually it started after the second wave of COVID. I think it was July when all parties, they started gearing up and holding rallies and meetings and all that. Congress too started, and at that time, it was almost clear that Congress party will do something, but as the electioneering progress, Congress party lagged behind because most of the leaders belonging to other parties, the smaller caste-based parties, they started aligning with Samajwadi Party or BJP.
Okay.
So ultimately, making it a bipolar election where there is little space for Congress and BSP both.
Okay.
Still, I feel that Congress is toiling hard to create a place for itself.
Okay.
But as the process goes on,
indeed, Siddharth, you're right there, and you know it's a long battle ahead. You know, it has just begun. Phase of polling in Uttar Pradesh will take place on 10th of February. That is almost a month from now. So quite a lot of work which needs to be put in by all political parties, be the ruling one or the opposition there as well. Let's now shift focus towards another, you know, northern state, that is Punjab. Mr. I.P. Singh, I'd like to bring in here quite a interesting scenario developing in Punjab out there. You know, a lot of movement politically, one, and two, in terms of statements, counter statements, issues. There seems to be no dearth of issues in Punjab in these elections.
There is no dearth, but what's peculiar this time is that Punjab is having almost unprecedented fluidity, political fluidity. I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty. Guesswork would be very tough, anything. Then if this fluidity is coming more from what happened within Congress in the last few months, right? And then farm movement had increased this fluidity in this political scene. AAP was able to gain some ground in perception battle, but no farmers have also decided, around 20 of their groups have made Sanyukt Samaj Morcha to contest the elections. So when they come into the picture, it's further complicated. So this poll math in Punjab is quite complicated. Of course, with the Congress is one party which is having support base across social sections, I mean, among scheduled castes, among Sikhs, among Hindus too. Akali Dal is still trying to recover its base, which was lost in the last 5-6 years among this core constituency, the Sikhs.
Okay.
It's still trying to recover that. And it has alliance with BSP this time. So it was expected that the scheduled caste vote, especially from Adidharmi Ravidasiya community, would shift to Akali Dal BSP alliance. But Congress, by placing Mr. Charanjit Singh Channi as Chief Minister, and he comes from the same caste background in which BSP is having its stronghold.
Okay.
So that has further complicated the situation for Akali Dal also.
Okay.
Then BJP has always remained a marginal player in Punjab. It was contesting around just 1/5 of the seats. So you can't expect it to expand in the across the state, its vote shares suddenly, I mean, across the states. Of course, they would be having votes in different constituencies which they were not earlier contesting, maybe in 3 digits, maybe in 4 digits.
But how will the alliance,
But
BJP's
they have
alliance
the
with Captain Amrinder Singh, turn out this time around? They have another alliance partner. So far in Punjab, it has always been BJP plus Shiromani Akali Dal.
Let me make it very clear. Captain Amrinder Singh, when he was in Congress, he addressed a very big constituency. He had never forgot that he had resigned against Operation Blue Star. So he was a major factor when Sikhs who had Congress had become very unpopular among Sikhs after Operation Blue Star and massacre of November 84. Then in 2002, before that, I mean, Captain Amrinder Singh had joined Congress 3 years before that. So Congress were able to return to power because it could recover its base among Sikhs also by that time. Now, for the last year or so, his constituency now is restricted mainly to, I mean, the BJP and Captain Amrinder Singh address largely the same constituency. You
Okay.
see, alliance helps if partners are bringing in different constituencies. So, and Akali Dal Sanyukt, which is led by Mr. Sukhdev Singh Dhindsa, that has base in limited this area
Okay.
in a couple of districts.
Okay.
So that would remain a challenge. Of course, it's a three-party alliance for now.
Andy?
And BJP is also taking some leaders from other parties, from Congress, from
Okay,
Akali Dal.
and a quick take,
But
Mr. Singh, before we move on to the next state, that is Goa. A quick take on Aam Aadmi Party there, because the same party is making forays into Goa as well. So just if you have to understand what's happening in Punjab vis-a-vis the Aam Aadmi Party.
yeah, आप यू सी आप वाज दी आप गॉट इट्स फर्स्ट मेजर सक्सेस इन पंजाब इन 2014 पार्लियामेंट इलेक्शंस. इट गॉट टू 24.5% वोट्स एट दैट टाइम एंड गॉट 4 MPs. बट आफ्टर दैट व्हेन दिल्ली सेंट्रलाइज्ड इट्स कंट्रोल ऑन द स्टेट यूनिट, इट्स वोट शेयर हैज बीन कमिंग डाउन. देयर वोट शेयर वाज लो इन 2017, इट ड्रॉप्ड बाय 0.7%. In 2019 parliament elections, they were reduced to 7.3% vote share.
Okay.
They were able to recover. They were able to catch the perception also. But now, as I told, as farmers have jumped into the fray and they have leveled serious allegations against AAP about distributions, about compromises on issues of integrity, so AAP would be facing a major challenge from farm groups when they contest on their own.
Okay. Okay, that's going to be a very interesting thing to watch out for in Punjab elections as well. Let me bring in here from Goa, Mr. Kishore Naik Kaonkar as well. As far as Goa is concerned, Mr. Kishore, it's not only just Aam Aadmi Party, but new entrants like, Trinamool Congress, TMC, is also trying to make forays out there. Congress seemingly is trying its level best to make a comeback. BJP would, of course, want to retain its, a fort in Goa.
Yeah, Goa is always known to be the tourist destination, but these days Goa is a very popular political tourist destination. As we have told that the new entrants like TMC, AAP, they are struggling very hard there to take Goa into their hands. Basically, Goa is a small state which consists of 40 assembly constituencies. And now from 2012 onwards, we have BJP government here in Goa. It is for last 10 years, BJP is in power. Of course, since 10 years is a big tenure, and obviously they will have anti-incumbency. But the thing is, all oppositions are divided against BJP. BJP's traditional alliance, that is MGP, is a regional party in Goa, has an alliance with TMC, and BJP is going alone, and all other parties are against BJP. So okay, obviously the votes are going to be divided, and the result of this division of votes will benefit the BJP because they have their strong organizational setup in Goa. Now the thing is, Congress party, which was the single largest party in 2017 elections, now has come to only two MLAs. All their MLAs have joined BJP. And now the thing is, now on the eve of this election, there is a vast move of MLAs and candidates into each other political parties. So there seems to be a political auctioning going on in Goa. Certainly, TMC and AAP has put up their strong strong power to get the power in Goa. But the division of votes among all the opponents will definitely help BJP. Now it is up to all political parties to come together and fight against BJP. Otherwise, the result will be obviously BJP will benefit with the division of power. Mm-hmm. Now, AAP has already declared their list of 20 candidates. There is a regional party there in Goa called Revolutionary Goans Party, which is basically a group of youths fighting for the identity of Goa,
okay,
Goikar. And TMC, obviously, TMC and MGP comes together, they have a better chance. But anyhow, people seems to be want these all opposition parties to come together. Otherwise, the division of votes will definitely help BJP to at least come to that figure of majority.
Okay. So there seems to be a very interesting electoral battle on hands in Goa as well. Let's now shift focus to Manipur. And Mr. Rocky Chan Singh is joining us from Manipur. Mr. Singh, the scenario in Manipur, if you could explain to our viewers, it is... the BJP is the ruling party right now. And in terms of not only the electoral strategies, but the issues there as well.
In Manipur, the election is between basically Bharatiya Janata Party and the Indian National Congress. And now, since Manipur is a small state, whatsoever the political party that comes power in the center have more impact in Manipur. It was happened in the UPA government. Mm-hmm. During the UPA government, Manipur has a Congress continuously for 3 terms. Manipur has Congress government. And likewise, since 2014, after the coming of BJP government in the center, Manipur for the first time Bharatiya Janata Party installed its first government in 2017.
Okay.
So after the installation of first government in Manipur in 2017, the state government is working in line with the central government, and in the matter of elections. Now, the battle is between BJP and the Indian National Congress.
Okay, and what are the key issues there in Manipur, Mr. Singh? Before we shift to another state, we would like to understand what are the major issues there on the ground in the state of Manipur?
Major issues, the present burning issues is AFSPA, Armed Forces Special Power Act. So, some political parties like National People's Party is demanding for removal of AFSPA from Manipur and other states of Northeast. And another thing is corruptions. These two, AFSPA and corruptions are the two main issues in Manipur. So political parties are working, especially this political parties that are not in government are working, are promising to remove AFSPA and to bring free, corruption-free government in Manipur.
Okay.
Whereas the ruling political party, Bharatiya Janata Party, is propagating that the BJP, this government, has given an inclusive government in the state and maintaining good law and order situations in the state. However, in the last 15 years, in the last 15 days, four people have killed in this election-related violence in Manipur. Recently, there before you study, two persons were killed in the Mayang Imphal Assembly constituency. These unwanted happenings are doing this time.
Indeed. And, indeed. This is indeed something which will be, definitely kept in check as far as the election violence is concerned, something which the Election Commission in its press conference also mentioned the day the dates were announced, and the entire, administrative machinery which is in there would obviously work on that aspect. But coming back to the politics of it all, or the electoral politics of it all, as you're mentioning, Mr. Singh, looks like, all political parties there in Manipur also have their hands full vis-a-vis issues. And of course, the attacks and counter-attacks between the ruling and the opposition will continue. Let's now move to Uttarakhand, back to another northern state. And Mr. Siddharth, as far as Uttarakhand is concerned, a common factor between Uttarakhand, Punjab and Goa is the presence of Aam Aadmi Party. Also, the battle in Uttarakhand seemingly is has always been Congress versus BJP. How does it look like this time around? And we've seen the entire, tenure of the BJP in the state has been quite eventful in terms of, several steps being taken vis-a-vis new chief ministers being put in place.
It's a very interesting situation there in Uttarakhand, because normally we used to see in Uttar Pradesh multi-corner elections and bipolar in Uttarakhand, but this time in Uttar Pradesh it's a bipolar one. And in Uttarakhand we are seeing at least three-cornered elections, with AAP being, Aam Aadmi Party being a new entrant, and rigorously campaigning in entire Uttarakhand. So as we were listening, Mr. Kishore, in Goa, the anti-establishment or anti-government votes being divided between so many parties, same applies here in Uttarakhand also, where obviously BJP was having some problem. That's why they had changed three chief ministers in a row. But when it comes to assembly elections, the people who are not happy with BJP, I mean, those who are not going to vote for BJP, their votes are divided between Aam Aadmi Party and Congress.
Okay.
And now it has to be looked into whether Aam Aadmi Party's presence is going to damage more to Congress or to BJP. But as per my information from both the regions, the Kumaon and the Garhwal regions, Aam Aadmi Party's presence is in both the regions, Kumaon and Garhwal, and mainly in the urban areas. So obviously, it is going to damage both the parties, Congress and the BJP. And when it comes to sharing the anti-incumbency votes, then obviously, Aam Aadmi Party is going to gain some of. Though I don't consider Aam Aadmi Party to emerge as a big player, I mean, number two or number one.
Okay.
But yes, its presence is going to benefit BJP up to some extent.
Okay.
Because all those who don't want to vote the present government, or those who are not happy with the present government, they have now two options. One is Congress and another is Aam Aadmi Party. And especially in the urban areas, Aam Aadmi Party, they are rigorously campaigning, and their candidates, they were the first one to announce the name of their candidate, and their campaign had picked up much before other parties.
You're right there, Mr. Siddharth. When it is a triangular contest, at least one will end up being, reaping the benefits of the battle between the other two. We'll have to wait and watch as to what happens in Uttarakhand out there and the other four states as well. Mr. Siddharth, Thank you so much, Mr. I.P. Singh as well, Mr. Rorke Chand Singh from Manipur, and Mr. Kishore from Goa for joining us and sharing your views and analysis of what is it that we can see in the weeks and days to come in these five states which are poll-bound, that is the state of Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Manipur, Goa and Punjab. Will keep a close watch on all the developments there and keep on bringing you all the details in perspective as well as in our other shows. So keep watching Sunset Television. Thank you.